Greetings. Let's start again another example on shear force and bending moment. Based on what we've done previously, at the previous session, we had two-point load and two reactions. Let's take another example on where we have an overhanging beam and a simply supported overhanging beam with one load this side and another load here. Let's assume that this load F1 is 10 kilonewtons, F2 is also 10 kilonewtons. Now the distances are given. This is 2 meters, this is 4 meters, and the other one is 2 meters. Support reaction A, support reaction B, and we have a point load C and another point load D. And the question is, draw the shear force and the bending moment diagram. First and foremost, we need to get the reactions A and B. And we know how to get the support reactions A and B, the sum of clockwise and anti-clockwise about B should be equal to zero, and this will definitely help us to get RA. And how do we express the equation itself? For this one about B, we'll have F2 times 2 clockwise minus F1 times 8 plus RA. Remember, this is the pin support. Always remember the component of the reaction, vertical and the horizontal, but here definitely there will be a zero in terms of horizontal component. Therefore, RAV is equal to RA. Here we have RB. Now, let's carry on with the equation. What are we having in the equation? RA will create, compared to B, RA will create a clockwise moment. The moment arm is 60, and everything should be equal to zero. What is the value of F2? It's 10, F1 is 10. Plus RA times 6 equal to 0. 20 minus 80 is equal to minus RA, 6 RA. Minus 60 is equal to minus 6 RA. And therefore, RA is equal to 10 kilonewtons, as we can see. Now, having RA, let's get RB. We do the same, but this time the moment about A. And the moment about A will generate the reaction RB. And what is the equation? We'll have F1 minus F1 times the moment arm, which is 2, because F1 creates an anti-clockwise moment, then followed by RB. Or followed, we can take F2. F2 will create a clockwise moment, and the moment arm will be F2 times 6. And RA creating RB creating an anti-clockwise B minus RB, that anti-clockwise moment, times the moment arm, which is 4, and everything will be equal to 0. And this will be minus 10 times 2 plus 10 times 6 equal to RB, 4RB. And this is minus 20 plus 60 equal to 4RB, and this will be 40T is equal to 4RB, and RB is also 10 kilonewtons. We have now RB and RA. RA and RB are equal. They all equal to 10 kilonewtons. You can see. Now we need to draw our shear force and bending moment diagram. Let's get it up. So that we can have enough space. We have the situation like this. We have F1 here with 10 kilonewtons. We have our pin support here. We have our roller support here. And we have F2 here, which is 10 kilonewtons. And the distances, you can just have all the lines like this. Here we have C, support A, support B. This distance was known as 4 meters. This one is 2 meters and 2 meters. We already have our reactions, and we now know how to proceed on how to get the shear force and bending moment diagram. Let's start with the shear force. Shear force starting at C here. This is C. I hope it can be seen clearly. Is where the force F1 is applied. Now, shear force at C left. What do we have at the left of C? It's 0. Shear force at C right. We are in this zone, and the remaining, when we are in the zone that is at the right of C, we only have one force, which is F1. And the value of F1 is 10 kilonewtons. We done with C, left and right. Then let's move to A. Shear force at A, left. We're still gonna have the same value because this is the zone that is at the left of A. And the only forces that are at the left of that zone is F1. And F1 known as 10 kilonewtons. Now, shear force at A right, the right of A, this zone, as we can see, we have the reaction RA. RA and the force F1. And the reaction RA is directed toward positive values of X minus F1. Because it's an algebraic sum that we're doing, and doing the algebraic sum, directions of the forces, the vector directions, or the direction of the vector forces will be taking the sides. And here, as we know, RA and F1 have the same value, yet will be 0 kilonewtons. Now let's take the shear force. We are done with the point A, left and right. Now let's take point B, left. It will be similar to the previous one because the left of B is in this zone. And if we situated in this zone, we look at the remaining algebraic sum because we're coming from that side, we only have the sum of F1 and the reaction, which will be similar to the previous situation. Now, let's take the shear force at B, right. Shear force at B right will be, we are in this zone, B right, and the remaining loading are the force F1 and the reactions. And F1 is going downward, plus RA plus RB. And this will be, this is 20 minus 10, this will be 10 kilonewtons. Now, then let's reach the D. D left will be similar to the previous equation because the same loading are remaining at the left, and we'll have again 10 kilonewtons. Now the shear force at D right, it's here. It means we have covered the whole beam with the load and the reactions. And therefore, we will have something like this. Minus F1 plus RA plus RB minus F2. And this sum should be equal to zero because it's summing up the load and the reactions. Now, let's plot now all the values that we have. This is the zero line. C right, we start from this point, C right is zero. The next point will be 10. C left is zero, C right, what are we gonna have? We need to be able to remember the signs. Because at the C level, we'll have the force that goes beyond, it goes down. Please remember the sign. About the sign, it will be a sign here. It means minus 10. What does it mean? Minus 10 is below the zero line. Let's take this and consider this as below the zero line. Then we are done with this and this. Then comes A left. We are on A. This is A, and the left of A will be also at the same level with C right, minus 10. And done with the A left. Now comes A right. A right is zero, means we get back to the zero line. Done with that one. B left. We are now on B. B left is zero, still on the same zero line. And then comes to B right. B right is 10, positive 10. This is the zero line. 10 is positive. Therefore, it should be above the zero line. And then comes B. D left, because B right is already there, and B left and B right are already recorded. Now we go to D left, which is also positive 10, and then D right is zero. And what we do is just joining this point by straight lines. And this is our shear force diagram. Whatever is below the zero line will be negative, and what is above the zero line will be positive. Now, from this diagram, we are capable of reading which cross-section of the beam is likely to be subjected by a very high shear force. Now, this is done for the shear force. Let's move on to the bending moment. We do the same as before last time. Bending moment is a moment, and when we do the bending moment diagram, we move on from the beginning of the beam, either from the left to the right or from the right to the left, but each point of the beam will be constituting a temporary pivot. And the forces that are remaining behind that point
will be constituting the force that will create the moment. Then we'll be expressing moment as we're moving from one point to another point of the beam. And that's how we get to a point of drawing the bending moment diagram. Now let's do it. Let's start point by point. We're going from the left to the right. Now let's take the bending moment at C. What do we have on C? We can see this, the load acting on the point C. Therefore, that load doesn't create nothing. There's a force F1 acting on the point load, and therefore there's nothing that is created in terms of moment. That force F1 acts and doesn't create a moment, and therefore whenever the force is acting on the pivot, there's no moment created because there's no perpendicular distance, there's no moment arm. Now let's move on our beam. What do we have? We go to point C, the point A, sorry, the BM at A, what is it gonna be? Then if we look at our bending moment, in that situation we can have something like this. And the free body diagram can be something like this. We have the force that is acting on C, and now we're talking about A as our temporary pivot. A becoming our temporary pivot, what's gonna happen? It's only the force F1 that will create a moment. And as we can see, this moment will be an anti-clockwise moment. As we can see, F1 creating an anti-clockwise moment with a moment arm which is equal to 2 meters. Therefore, the expression will be minus F1 times the moment arm which is 2 meters. And this will be minus 10 times 2, which is 20, minus 20 kilonewtons meters. That's the unit of the moment as we know it. The next point, we are at point C. No, sorry, point B. Now, point B, this is how our free body diagram will be. Oh, this is how the situation will be. B becomes our current pivot. And what do we have here? We can see we have the reaction RA, and B being a pivot, RB doesn't create a moment because it's on the pivot. And what are we going to have in terms of our equation? Bending moment at B will be, if we are at B, F1 creating an anticlockwise moment, minus F1 with the moment arm, which is 6, plus RA creating a clockwise moment, and the moment arm is 4. And if we do the total here, it will be minus 10 times 6 plus 10 times 4, which is minus 60 plus 40, which is minus 20 kilonewtons meters. As we can see, F1 to B is 6 in terms of moment arm, and the moment is negative. RA to B, the moment arm is 4, and the moment is positive, and then 10 times 4 minus 10 minus 6, which will give us the same number than the previous one, but it's 5. Now, the next point will be the point D, bending moment at D. What is it gonna be? The bending moment at D. Will be F1 times 8, and the moment is anti-clockwise. Moment arm is anti-clockwise. The moment is anti-clockwise, but the moment arm is 8. Then followed by a clockwise moment created by the reaction RA. Moment arm is 6. Followed by a clockwise moment created by the reaction RB, and the moment arm is 2. And if we do the total here, what is it going to be? This is minus 80 plus 60 plus 20, and the total will be equal to 0. Obviously, it should be 0, because we need to close up the diagram. And these are the values that we have. Minus 20, minus 20, first of all, 0, minus 20, minus 20, and 0. These are the values that we've managed to get for the moment, the bending moment, a different point of the beam. Now let's start plotting them on our diagram. And this is our zero line for the bending moment. At C, the bending moment tells us that it's equal to 0, and we are at 0 here. And let's remember what we said previously. We can either plot it above zero line, mathematically speaking, it makes sense, or we can plot it below, but putting the sign positive. Now, let's put it below, but we'll put the positive sign. Now, the next is minus 20. Minus 20, it's below. Well, let's just follow the mathematical way of doing it. Below. Minus 20 is at A. Let's assume that minus 20 is here. And at B, we also have minus 20. And at D, it's 0. Now what do? We join this by straight lines. And this is how it will be. And we should put our signs here, because we don't have to put a sign because we plotted the negative values, but we can also put this on top. If we put it on top, we then need to put the sign here. Because the top normally represent the positive values. But if we put this like this, we need to mention the sign. But it doesn't matter as long as we've already put the values here. This is our free body diagram. Sorry, this is our shear force diagram and the bending moment diagram for the case that is given here. We'll take another example. With distributed loads or applied moments, depending on what application that we have.